Good morning, friends and visitors here at Granite Bay Hilltop. We're so glad that you joined us for our Sabbath School Study Hour. And this is a wonderful time for us to come together and just to delve into these different aspects of the Word of God. I also want to welcome those who I know are watching on television or on social media. And we have, of course, some of our members. This church has members around the world that have no local church they can attend. And there's some of our online or our digital members. We welcome you as well. Today, we're going to continue in our study dealing with the crucible of Christ. And I was telling our presenter a few minutes ago, you could go a long time and a long way in many directions with our study today dealing with seeing the invisible. There's a whole world out there that we don't see. And we're going to be getting to that in the lesson. We do have a free offer today, and it's called Determining the Will of God. And if you'd like a copy of this lesson, a lot of people wonder, if I've got to make a decision, I have two or three good choices, how do I know what God wants me to do? Do I cast lots, or can I just pray or ask a friend? And this book goes through about 12 biblical methods of how you can know the will of God. If you'd like a copy of this, or maybe you know someone struggling with understanding the will of God for their lives, then we invite you to simply call. You can ask for it. It's 866-788-3966. That's 866-STUDY-MORE. And you can ask for offer number it's offer number 778. If you want to text, you text SH025 and you text that to 40544 to get your copy. If you're outside the U.S., you can just go to study.aftv.org and ask for SH025, and you can download that there. Well, before we have our prayer and get into the lesson, you can see we've got some special music planned. Amen. That's some heavenly music. Thank you so much. Well, let's have prayer together before we get into our study for today. Loving Lord, we're very thankful for your blessing, your sacrifice, that you were willing to go through the crucible that we might be sanctified and fit to live with you in glory. Lord, we pray in a special way you'll be with our presenter today and grant him the Holy Spirit and that we all might be edified. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Our teacher today is going to be Pastor Alden Ho.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to be here this Sabbath morning with you. This is a very interesting topic that we have this morning, and it's seeing the invisible. If it's possible, can I get some monitors here? Seeing the invisible. I thought at first this is kind of a little bit of a vague topic because it's kind of broad and you can go any which way. And I was talking to Pastor Doug in the back. He says, oh, this is great because you can go here and you could go there. And I started thinking, well, yeah, I'm usually trying to think in the box with it. But sometimes it's good to think out of the box. So I want to share this illustration with you. There was, at the University of Southern California, there was a professor of philosophy. He was a very, very staunch atheist. And as a result of his atheism, he would always say to the class at the end of the semester, 300 students there, he would hold up a piece of chalk and he would say, if there is a God, he could stop this piece of chalk from breaking on the ground. And he would drop that piece of chalk and it would shatter into hundreds of pieces. Every semester for 20 years, he would tell the class this story. But he would say first, is there anybody here who's a Christian? And he would ask them, but nobody would stand up to the professor because they were very scared. And sure enough, over the 20 years, probably 40 semesters or so, there have been a few Christians that have slipped in and out, silent, not saying anything. Well, a few years ago, there was a freshman who enrolled in the class nervously because he had known that this professor has been notorious for his staunchness in atheism. Well, as a result of this, this student prayed every day that the Lord would give him the opportunity and give him the courage to be able to stand. Well, that day came. The very last day, all of a sudden, the professor stood up and he said, is there anybody here who is a Christian? This young man stood up and the professor yelled at him and he says, you fool, because if there is a God, he could stop this piece of chalk from breaking on the ground. And just as he was about to let the chalk go, it slipped out of his fingers, rolled off of his cuff, hit the pleat of his pants, hit his shoe, and rolled onto the floor unscathed. The professor ran out of the class. He was astonished. Never before in the 20 years has that ever happened. And that young man came to the front amid cheers from all the classmates. And for the next half hour, he shared with them the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, seeing the invisible for us is a very real or very unreal thing for us. The challenge that we have today is we're Laodiceans. And we're told here in the book, The Story of Redemption, it says, many have present wants supplied. Yet they do not trust the Lord for the future. I'm sure all of you opened your fridge, opened your cupboards this morning, and you had plenty of food there. There was no need to really trust the Lord like the woman who had no food for her son, only had a little bit of oil, only had a little bit of flour left, and told Elijah, we're just going to go in, make a small fire, we're going to cook this, and then we're going to eat it, and we're going to die. This quote goes on, it says, they manifest unbelief and sink into despondency and gloom at anticipated want. Some are in continual trouble, lest they shall come to want for their children to suffer. When difficulties arise, and when they are brought into strait places, when their faith and their love for God are tested, they shrink from the trial and murmur at the process, by which God has chosen to purify them. Have you ever thought about it that from that standpoint? This is God's way of purifying us. And many of us complain at that purification process. You see, for us today, present wants equals our Laodicean condition. Revelation 3:17 says, because you say that you are rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing, and you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. We're told here in Gospel Workers that Jesus does not call on us to follow him and then forsake us. If we surrender our lives to his service, we can never be placed in a position for which God has not made provision for us. Whatever may be our situation, we have a guide to direct our way. Whatever perplexities we face, we have a sure counselor. Whatever our sorrow, bereavement, or loneliness, we have a sympathizing friend. If in our ignorance we make missteps, Christ does not leave us. His voice, clear, distinct, is heard, and he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And God will deliver the needy when we cry. He is not deaf to our cry. But yet some will say, and we've heard some people say the following, if God really loved me, he would certainly have done blank for me. You've heard that before? Maybe even you might have said that before yourself. And I wonder sometimes at the thought that flickers through our minds when we look at these circumstances. And we begin to wonder, we not just wonder, but we begin to question God. Does God really love us? Because if he really did, things would be different, wouldn't it? In Romans chapter 8, verse 28, we're told that all things work together for good for them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. But you know, in the commentary, the Bible commentary, it says, it is our knowledge that according to the eternal purpose of God, all things contribute to the welfare of those who love him. All things, even the troubles, even the sufferings of this life, far from hindering our salvation, it may help us actually to move forward. And we find that at every step, the Christian may be in the hands of God and be carrying out a divine purpose. God's plan is not to hinder us. God's plan is to help us. So we have to get that straight to understand that. In Romans, it says that Romans 8:32, it says, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give all things? God is wanting to give good gifts to our children. Amen? In this particular verse of Romans 8:32, we're told that the Lord's touching commendation on Abraham in this conduct of offering up his son Isaac gives us a glimpse into the Spirit of God's act in surrendering his own son Jesus. The greatest of all gifts is the strongest of all proofs that God is for us. If God didn't care for us, why in the world would he give us his only son? Think about that for a moment. Why would he allow his son to go through all that anguish if he didn't love you or I? You know, I think about this song that it just struck me. I've heard this song for decades. And you have too, but I don't know if you've actually allowed the words to soak in. The song title is The Love of God. You all know this song. But think of these words, and I'm just going to read the first and the third verses to you. It says, the love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest stars and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. The third verse just floors me. And when it really hit me I had tears in my eyes as I thought about this. Reflect on this, third verse. If we, with ink, the ocean well fill, if we, with ink, the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints' and angels' song. That is the God we serve. That is the God that sent his Son to die for you and I. In Monday's lesson, titled In the Name of Jesus, we look at the following, and I want to bring you to the book of John, John chapter 14. We're going to look at verse 13, and it says here, and whatever you ask in my name, meaning if you ask in the name of my Son Jesus, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. So according to these two verses, 13 and 14, Jesus promises to do for us anything. I mean, is that really anything? Can I get on my knees and ask the Lord, I would like to have a red Ferrari? Is that anything? That's anything, but that's not anything in what? His name. You got the idea. So it depends on what you're asking in his name. But then the question is, how much does God love us? He loves us a lot. In fact, I asked Jesus how much he loved me, and he spread his arms and he died for me. That's how much. And John 3:16 reiterates this, for God, say it with me, for God so loved the world that he gave his, that whosoever believes in him, but have everlasting life. In Desire of Ages, one of my favorite books, 667, it says, the Lord is disappointed when his people place a low estimate upon themselves. He desires his chosen heritage to value themselves according to the price he has paid or placed upon them. God wanted them, else he would not have sent his Son on such an expensive errand to redeem them. He has a use for them, and he is well pleased when they make the very highest demand upon him, and that they may glorify his name, that they may expect larger things if they have faith in his promises. Some people have asked, is there a difference whether I pray to God or whether I pray to Jesus? Is there a difference? I find that when we look at verse 14, John chapter 14, verse 14, the commentary tells us the following. If you ask, and it says in the insertion here, in the pronoun, it says, as you ask of me, after the verb ask, this reading would imply that the petition may be directed to Jesus as well as the Father. There are several New Testament examples of prayer directed to Jesus. However, the expression, ask me anything, implies that my name is awkward, or hence the reading that includes a pronoun me would probably be rejected. So we can ask of Jesus, we can ask of God, because they are one in the same, are they not? Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen my Father. I and my Father are one. So praying in the name of Jesus also implies that it is not your will, but it has to be his will. In Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9, Isaiah writes the following, and he says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So what do we find from there? It's not about what we want. It's about our needs. God already knows. Did you know that? He already knows what we need before we ask of him. You're aware of that. There's no time where you would pray and God listening, he would say, really? You want that? He already knows. It's not a surprise to him. He's omniscient. He knows that. He's been there. He's done that. In Acts of the Apostles, page 33, it says, the disciples met together to present the request to the Father in the name of Jesus. They knew that they had a representative in heaven, an advocate at the throne of God. In solemn awe, they bowed in prayer, repeating the assurance, whatsoever you ask in my name, in the name of my Father, he will give you. Hitherto, have you asked anything in my name? Ask, and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. Higher and still higher, they extended the hand of faith, and the mighty argument, it is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. And that's what we know today. Where is Jesus today? He is in the most holy place. And what is he doing? He is doing the work of intercession. This is the time of the Day of Atonement for us, the atonement time period. And so he is going between us and the Father for us. This brings us to Tuesday's lesson. In Tuesday's lesson, the power of the resurrection. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 18, it says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. The eyes of your understanding be enlightened. We're told that this is seeing the invisible. So it seems to be that Paul uses the expression here, eyes, to represent perhaps insight, enlightenment, spiritual awareness, or maybe moral comprehension. But we're also told here in 1 Corinthians that eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, what the spirituality opened eyes see. So we find that a new and a deep illumination takes place that affects the innermost personality. It is not a new faculty or a new gift. It is a new vision. It is a new insight. And this is what happens when we come to Jesus. We have a new experience. It's not this worldly experience, but it is an experience of getting to know God through all this. We'll talk a little bit more about this in a few more minutes here. But when we're talking about the verse of Philippians or Ephesians 8, 1:18, the eyes of your understanding, it says, be enlightened. This is directly from reading from the Bible here, Ephesians 1:18. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints, verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly place. Verse 21, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet. And he gave him to be head over the things in the church, which is his body, and the fullness of him who fills all in all. I was very moved when I read the following from the devotional book, That I May Know Him. It says, the Lord is dishonored when any who profess his name have an emptiness. This misrepresents God. Do you know that? Let me put it to you in a very practical sense. You have non-Christian friends. You express doubts. Sometimes you worry. You fret about things where you should have faith. That is a misrepresentation of a Christian. and it misrepresentates God also. Nothing but Christ manifested in spirit and life and character can reveal God to a world that knows him not, just like that college philosophy professor. The soul renewed in the knowledge of God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent, demonstrates its divine fullness in a living, growing experience, even the fullness of him that filleth all things. When Jesus was talking on the Sermon on the Mount, he used an illustration that we find in Matthew chapter 7, verse 15, and it says, "Enter by the narrow gate." You've all heard this before. "For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way that leads to life, and few find it." Not last week, but the week before, I was in Fargo, North Dakota. There's a lot of crops out there, a lot of crops, but there's not many cattle like some places. But I want to talk to you about cattle for a moment. You know, when you go to a cattle area, they open the gate. Sometimes the gate is kind of like a V-shaped gate so that it's not for the cattle. It's actually for human beings. So it's from a bird's eye view, it looks like this, but then it has this piece there. So you walk in, you have to turn sideways, and then you walk out. So if you're walking up to the gate, you go in like this, and then you go out like that. The whole purpose of that is to keep the cattle out. But you can go in. And sometimes it's very narrow. Sometimes you have to squeeze. Have you ever been spelunking before? You know what spelunking is? How many of you know what spelunking is? Few people do. That's when you get in and you go caving, not like normal people go caving, where you walk in like, oh, look, a big cave. Oh, no, these are the people who I think sometimes their IQ is a little low, but they go into places that, you know, you may not fit through there, but they still try to go through those places. But understand this, when you go through those places, you can't have your cell phone in your pocket. You can't have your wallet in your pocket because that will jam you. You see, this is the purpose of the narrow gate. It's to limit you. It's to restrict you so that you can't bring perhaps your self-reflecting mirror in, something that shows who you are, all the things about you. It's to limit us. But here's the thing that is the biggest difference. Once you are through the gate, then it's wide open. Is it not? So the non-Christian thinks that the Christian life is very narrow. Well, why would they get that image? Well, they get that image from us because we say, well, we can't do this, we don't do that, we don't do this, we don't eat that. Instead of saying, what we can do. John 10:10 says, I came that you might have life and you might have it more restrictively, right? No, abundantly. That's the whole point of the whole thing. I came that you can have life more abundantly. But notice, the abundance is not on this side of the fence. It's on the other side of the fence. You have to be restricted of yourself and your wants. Once you're through, you can ask anything in his name, and it will be done for you. From the book, the devotional book by Ellen White, it says, today, Satan has great power in the world. He has been permitted to have proprietorship of this earth for an appointed time. During this period, when iniquity prevails, men and women are given a chance to take sides. In every possible way, Satan tries to make the broad road attractive and the narrow road grievous, humiliating, and objectionable. He lays his ingenious plans to allure men and women to indulge appetite, cheap, unsatisfying plans that will cause pleasure and make all and in all in the degenerate age. Satan throws his glamour about these amusements, which eclipse eternal things. Many will sell their birthright, just as Esau did, for a trifling consideration for an indulgence of appetite. Worldly pleasures will appear more desirable to them than the heavenly birthright. In Wednesday's lesson, the title is To Carry All Our Worries. There's a very funny illustration I came across. There was a woman who for many years had trouble sleeping at night. She always feared that there would be burglars in her house. One night, she was lying in bed. Her husband was next to her, and they heard something in the house. He went downstairs to investigate, and sure enough, there he found a burglar. He turned on the light, looked at the burglar, and said, "Good evening. I am pleased that you are here. Would you mind coming upstairs to meet my wife? She's been waiting for you for the last 10 years. Worry does us nothing. You realize that. It does us nothing. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, it says, "Therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, nor about your body and what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing?" What does that mean? Does that mean that, forget about eating. Eating is overrated. Dressing is overrated. I guess for Pastor Doug in the cave, it was overrated too. But for us today, the importance here is Jesus does not condemn. He's not condemning because of the habits of worrying about the material things, especially about those that are over and above necessities of life. We don't have to deal with the extravagance. Just depend on God for the basics. He condemns the desire that leads to extravagance in every direction. The important thing here is Jesus says that He says that which should receive the greater attention is the life itself. Food, important as it is not an end in itself, but rather it's a means to the end of supporting life. The man whose primary objective is to secure food and clothing has missed the most important thing in life. We should eat to live, not live to eat. Very important. There's another song that comes to mind, having been in music for so many years, and my dad used to sing a lot. This one, I remember, it just reflected on me now who I remember hearing this sing. Do you remember the old name, Del Decker? She sang this song, "The chimes of time ring out the news. Another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you? You may have longed for added strength, your courage to renew. Do not be disheartened, for I have news for you." Do you remember that, how it goes? It is no secret what God can do. What He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. What does worrying accomplish? I'll tell you what. What worrying does, it actually is a reflection of your own personal faith. Many of us talk, but when the rubber meets the road, that's when the action really comes. I had a church member in one of the churches I pastored talked all about faith, but boy, when things began to cave in a little bit, you can just see that little house just fall apart. Her whole house of faith just became very visible for everybody to see. For us too, we may talk it, but people are watching, and they want to see how we live it. From the Selected Messages, Volume 3, 325, it says, "Think of the Savior. Lay your sins, both of admission and of commission, upon the sin bearer. You know that you love the Lord, then do not worry away your life because Satan harasses you with his falsehoods. Believe that Jesus will and does pardon your transgression. He bore the sins of the whole world. He loves to have the weak and the troubled soul come to him and rely upon him." Then she says, "Seek God in simple faith, saying, I believe, help thou my unbelief." We get to Thursday's lesson. Thursday's title is "Still Faithful When God Cannot Be Seen." Have you seen God? I haven't seen God. But yet Isaiah chapter 40, verse 27 says, "My way is hidden from the Lord, and my just claim is passed over by my God." You see, what we're told here from the book This Day with God, God has sent messages from his word to the souls who are living careless lives. That's today. And who are ashamed of their wrong course of action. If the careless, self-indulgent soul would seek the Lord and confess his sins, they would see how their unconverted lives lead others astray. And they would repent and be converted. When we look at this, we have to understand God is certainly watching. Does he care for you? How many of you think God really cares for you? Can I see your hands? Only about half of you. God definitely cares. And I know all of you believe that, because if you didn't, then you really wouldn't be here. But does he care about the little nuances? Because if the title is still faithful when God cannot be seen, how do we communicate with God? We communicate with God through prayer. One of my most favorite stories comes out of the book The Day of Prayer, and it was done by the General Conference in 1999. On one of the days, there's the story that is told by a Brazilian missionary who was in Brazil, obviously. There was a lady who had four children. She had absolutely no money left, 20 cruzados, I think, or 5 cruzados, which was something like 20 cents. That's all she had. The cupboards were empty. The fridge was empty. She had four little children. What is she to do? She told the children, "I'm going to go pray. Don't bother me while I'm praying." And she went to her bedroom. She shut the door, and for 2 hours, she prayed. She asked the Lord to provide for her. The Lord knows her situation. And what was the result? The Lord told her to go to the supermarket called El Dorado's and to get all the groceries that she would need for 3 months. When was the last time you went out grocery shopping for 3 months? 3 months. 3 grocery carts overflowing. She just filled them up. She's dragging these grocery carts, and she goes. Now, El Dorado's is not a small store. You've all been to Costco, you've all been to Sam's. If you haven't, the blessing's upon you, because it's a crazy place there. But if you go to El Dorado's, they had 124 checkouts. That's big. Well, God told her to go to checkout stand number, come on, say it with me, 7. Come on, that's his number, 7. God told her to go to checkout stand number 7, and that she did. She went to number 7. And you know what happened when she went to 7? The lady, the cashier, this shut off her light and said, "Sorry, I'm going to lunch. You can go to number 6 or you can go to number 8. What a quandary. What are you going to do now? You wait. She waited there. And number 6 said, "Come on over." Number 8 said, "Come on over." She said, "No, my father told me to go to checkout stand number 7. And they're like, "Yeah, you're pretty crazy." She waited. The lady came back from her lunch break and said, "What? You're still here?" She said, "Yeah, my father told me to go through number 7. Calmly, she started putting all the groceries on the conveyor belt, checked everyone through, 3 grocery carts full. The total rings up. She's just standing there in total faith because God told her to go there. The lady told her the total, and she just smiled. And then, all of a sudden, over the public address system, there's a message, a voice that says, "Welcome to El Dorado's. Today is a very special day. We are celebrating our 7th anniversary. And the person at checkout stand number 7 gets their groceries free." Can you believe that? That, my friends, is having faith when God cannot be seen. You know, we're at a disadvantage. We're disadvantaged because we don't have what the disciples had. They were able to see God. They were able to see Jesus. They were able to touch Jesus. They heard his sermons. They saw the miracles he had performed. But the problem is, for us, we don't actually have those. We don't have that opportunity to actually see Jesus. Imagine what a change that would be in our lives if we could. But I'm telling you this, the way things are going in the world today, it is definitely not going to be long before we see him. Do you agree? You see, Jesus told us in his absence that he would send the Comforter to us. He would send us the Holy Spirit. And this is what he wants to do in our lives today. I want to jump back for a second to Isaiah chapter 40, verse 27, when he says, "My way is hidden from the Lord, and my just claim is passed over by God." The Bible commentary says, many in Judah felt that God had forgotten them and that he was not treating them justly. But there were many things that they didn't understand. They failed to understand. Seated at his throne in heaven, God sees all. God knows all, and he takes everything into consideration. He weighs carefully every factor out there, the past as well as the future. There are things that he fails to consider. There are things that he does not fail to consider. No detail that escapes his notice. Whatever he does is wise, right, and just, and good. Who is man to feel that he is being neglected and treated unjustly by God? Who do you think you are sometimes to say to God these things? When I was lying in my hospital bed after being pulled out of the plane that was well beneath the water, I sat in the bed and I remember having just come from the funeral of the pilot who was my boss, and the casket was right here. And it was one of these churches where you just have a clear center aisle. And my foot was in a cast, so it was sticking straight out. And where do you put somebody in a wheelchair? Right in the middle of the aisle. And I remember seeing that closed casket, and I remember crying like I've never cried before. But I never questioned God. I never said, "Why? Why did you do this to me?" Never questioned him. I just went beyond the question. And I just said, "What do you want with my life? What do you want?" I mean, I went back to the hospital room and I actually had a little bit of a yelling thing with God. It was one way because he didn't say anything to me, at least not right away. But I just said, "What do you want? Tell me what you want. Just lay it all out. I'll do it." But God doesn't just take the blueprint and lay it all out and say, "Okay, here's what you're going to do." He doesn't do that. He takes us one step at a time. And when we accomplish one step, then we're ready for the next step. He doesn't lay it all out. Because if he lays it all out, what's the tendency for us? "Oh, let me just jump from here to here," right? So he has to taper it so that one step prepares us for the next step. And that step prepares us for the next step. Remember Peter's ladder? It had 8 rungs. You can't jump from rung 1 to rung 4. You actually had to go 1, 2, 3, 4. Add to this, add to that. That's what God is trying to do in our lives. He's trying to teach us. Some of us have little faith. We talk it, but we have little faith. So God has to take us and to teach us to trust in him first. And through trusting in him, then he'll take us to the next step. And then the next step. and then the next step beyond that. It says here, has not God said he would give us the Holy Spirit to them that ask? And is not this Spirit a real, true, actual guide? Some men seem afraid to take God at his word, as though it would be presumption to them. They pray for the Lord to teach them, and yet are afraid to credit the pledged word of God and believe we have been taught of him. So long as we come to our Heavenly Father humbly and with a spirit to be taught, willing and anxious to learn, why should we doubt God's fulfillment of his own promise? You must not for a moment doubt him and dishonor him thereby. When you have sought to know his will, your part in the operation with God is to believe that you will be led and guided and blessed in doing his will. We may mistrust ourselves, lest we misinterpret his teachings, but make even this a subject of prayer and trust him, and still trust him to the utmost that his Holy Spirit will lead you to interpret aright his plans and the working of his providence. Brothers and sisters, as I close this lesson today, I say to you this: seeing the invisible today has a lot to do, it has everything to do with our faith. And remember, everybody is watching, especially those who know not God. As you live your life, be an example to those around. Be an example to angels, to men, and live for Jesus in all that you do. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity to be able to study the invisible, seeing the invisible, but we ask and pray that you would allow us to not just see, to feel, to understand, and to trust what we cannot see. Be with us today. Guide and direct our thoughts. Help us to remember the Sabbath day. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.